church family. How we doing this morning? Let's stand to our feet. Is anybody ready to give the Lord praise for all that he's done? Is anybody ready? Come on, let's lift up praise. Let's lift our voices. Worship with us this morning. Let's sing this really loud. Let's sing every praise.
Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship in one of
worship, you better be after that song. Thank you, Darrell, for leading us. And a little known secret, but I sound like that when I'm in my car by myself, all right? Just like Darrell there. And so thank you for being here. On behalf of our entire team here at Champion Forest, we welcome you to services today, and it is going to be a great day. In fact, why don't you just turn around and just acknowledge somebody's here, give them an air fist bump, an air high five, tell them you're glad to see them. We're being COVID safe around here. We are, all right. You can go ahead and be seated. And as you're taking a seat, again, we just want to welcome you to services today. My name is Jarrett Stevens. I have the privilege of serving as the pastor here. To all of you who are watching online, welcome to you as well. And if you're a guest, I want you to feel free to go ahead and you can text your name to the number on the screen right here. And we would love to know who you are. Just say thank you for being here. And we want to see if we can answer any questions for you about our church, get you plugged into the life and ministry of Champion Force. Because let me tell you something, God is doing special in this faith community known as Champion Forest. I was just on our campuses yesterday and just blown away by the car care ministry that we have. I think we brought some pictures for you to see. Now, I know you may be used to this because this has been going on for like 30 years here. We got a group of men led by Frank Allen and his team that come and for the half a day on Saturday just for widows in our church, for single parents in our church and in our surrounding community. Anybody can come. They get their oil changed. They get new filters put in their car. They get all their fluids topped off. Let's give it up for these guys that serve so faithfully. Man, it was unbelievable. I couldn't believe it. Now, again, I know you're used to it, but I've never seen anything like it. I just showed up, and I kind of showed up as the supervisor, all right? Every job needs a supervisor, and I was just blown away by these men and just their heart. And then the ladies come into the Family Life Center, and they've got coffee there and refreshments there, and they're being ministered to, and it was just so great to see. I asked Frank, I said, man, who pays for all this? Do you pay for this? He said, no, the church does. I said, y'all pay for this, man. This is awesome. And so if you never thought that your giving was making a difference, let me just tell you something. There's about, 30, 40 widows, single parents that say very different. You are taking care of them. So I just want to say thank you, Champion Forest, for the way that you give, your generosity. I went across the street, and there at our community ministry building, we were giving out food to those in our community. And I mean, I'm telling you, this parking lot was full yesterday. People coming on our campus, receiving the love of Christ. And this is what it's all about. I mean, we exist. We share the love of Jesus in tangible ways by rolling up our sleeves and serving people in His name. And we share the love of Jesus with our mouths, sharing with the life-changing message of the gospel. And this is what we were doing. And I'm just so thrilled to be a part of a church that's so on mission. Everything you do is on mission. For goodness sakes, this week I had a meeting with the Angel Paul's ministry, all right? I didn't even know this existed, this pet therapy ministry. Unbelievable. And they bring their dogs in. They came into my office, two dogs, all right? I'm sitting there being ministered to by these dogs. And we're talking to Debbie Benningfield, who runs this ministry. And as you know, she said she can take any pet and make them a therapy pet just about. And I'm not convinced. She doesn't know my dog. But they're unbelievable. They go into hospitals, and they'll just be there for kids to pet. For patients who are going through things just as comfort and care. And I was talking about worry and anxiety. That's what we're talking about in the message today. And she was telling me that it's scientifically proven. You know, they bring these animals in here and just chemicals in the brain when these animals begin to interact with these patients. I thought it was so interesting that they don't have cats. It's just dogs. And so, no, I'm just kidding. All right, look, do not email me, okay? I'm a cat lover. Do not email me. I did it for the joke, all right? I did it for the laugh. But listen, if you want to be involved in this ministry, they're going to be at the missions booth today. And Debbie, as a matter of fact, they take them into Freedom House, which is a ministry that helps young ladies coming out of sex trafficking. And today at our North Klein campus, one of these ladies who they brought their dogs in there at the Freedom House, and just through conversation, they begin to share the gospel. And again, those animals help lower that guard. And a lady from the Freedom House trusted Christ and is being baptized today at North Klein. Come on, all right? That's what it's all about. And so good. God is doing a great work, and I just want us to pray, thank the Lord for what He's doing in this time, and we're going to have a great day worshiping Him. And so would you bow your heads in prayer with me right now? Father, in Jesus' name, we welcome You into this place. Lord, we know where two or three are gathered, You are here with us. Your Spirit is here. And so, Lord, as we worship You, let us engage You. Lord, no going through the motions today. Lord, our hearts are Yours. We put our minds on You. Stir our affections today through worship and the teaching and preaching of Your word. Draw us close today, Lord. We want to leave never the same, God. And so help us. For those today that are struggling with worry and anxiety, and Lord, their heart is heavy, I pray that through the teaching and preaching of Your word in just a moment, that You, by the power of the Holy Spirit, would encourage them, challenge them, and give them tools, Lord, through the message today to help them on their journey. Thank you for being a God of peace that loves us, is always for us. And we ask you to do, Lord, in this next hour, what only you can do. In the name of Jesus, we pray. And all God's people said, amen.
Come on, church, let's stand together and sing this. Let's declare it. Sing it out with all we have in us this morning. Come on, sing this with me.
When darkness tries to roll across my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I own, when brokenness and pain is all I know, oh, I won't be shaken, no, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love.
God, we thank you. Church, let's continue in worship and just lift high the name of our God. Our God who fights our battles. Our God who goes before us. As we sing this, let's make it our prayer this morning.
Even now, I can see darkness is fading.
brick by brick will come down. Oh, your light will shine, lifting me out of the shadow. Oh, here and now, I know where my breakthrough is found.
Yes, I do.
I'm gonna sing my way out of the valley. I'm gonna shout my way up to the mountain. I will take hold of the truth of the promise. I'm gonna praise, I'm gonna praise. I'm gonna push through till every light comes. I'm gonna dance in the midst of the rain. I'm gonna rest in
you.
that song. It's one of my favorite songs that we sing, and I love the line that says, I'm going to push through till every lie crumbles. And, you know, this morning I think God just wants to remind us that the enemy would lie to us. The enemy would tell us that we are defined by our feelings, we are defined by our circumstances, we're defined by the things around us. But God's word says that we are not defined by all those things, but we are defined as ransomed children of the King. And our God, who was faithful to David, I was sitting here thinking about worry and anxiety. Just think about the life of David all through the Psalms. It's just a book full of worry and anxiety and distress. But each time God comes through and he gives David, the psalm writer gives it over to our God. And church, I just want to remind us that what our God did back then, the same God of the Old Testament, the same God of the New Testament, the same God of the 20s and the 50s and the 70s is still God today. And the same God that has sustained the church will sustain the church forever. And so we just want to sing this song and just say, God, we know that you've been faithful, and we trust you to continue to be faithful. So God, what you have done in the past, come, do it again.
We believe in every promise you have. We just want to encounter you, Jesus. Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won up, for you have never failed me yet. Can we sing it out, church? Your promise. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. declare it. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Faithful. I'm still in your
provider, that you are Savior, that you are King, that you are holy, you are worthy, you are perfect, you are omnipotent, almighty, Father and Daddy, and we praise you and worship you this morning. It's through the blood of Jesus we pray. Amen. Would you please be seated?
I felt like I was underwater and I wasn't coming up for air. You know, growing up, my dad always showed signs like he was an alcoholic. And as years went by, they just kept getting worse and worse. And I guess around high school, we saw that it was becoming a problem with everyday life. You know, he was missing work, breaking relationships with important people in our lives, and you know, resorting to any means to just get that fix, you know, for his alcohol. So eventually we ended up confronting him about it, and he kind of just said that we were very, very wrong and he didn't have an issue. And you know, the next day just picked up his things and just left and really never came back. So it just started building anxieties and insecurities within my heart, like, why couldn't my dad choose our family over the alcohol? Or, you know, was I worthy of love? If my dad couldn't pick me, why would anybody love me? So, you know, this just kind of followed on into my adult life. And my walls were so high that, you know, I was pushing away the people that really loved me and really cared, which was my husband, sometimes my kids, you know, because I would get so wrapped up in my worries, and I couldn't stay focused on the things that really mattered. It's just very overwhelming. Physically, it would manifest itself in like stomach problems and hyperventilating and, you know, the sweaty palms, the nausea, just a real ugly feeling. And it would get to the points where I couldn't sleep, I couldn't eat, or I was up all night just cleaning, organizing. I would just get really overwhelmed and I would start crying. And I didn't know why I was crying. I couldn't control it. It would just keep going and going. And, you know, my husband would look at me and say, "What's wrong?" And I would say, "I don't know. I just feel hopeless." I had gotten to the point where anxiety and worry had completely consumed my everyday life.
I think all of us have probably felt like Jessica at one time or another, maybe not to the same degree, but certainly we know what it is to feel anxious. That last sentence she shared in her video story is heartbreaking. "I feel hopeless. I got into the point where anxiety and worry had completely consumed my everyday life." You know, there's some messages that we preach up here on a weekly basis, and I'll look at the text and look at the subject that we're dealing with, and I know it's going to help some people, but I don't know that it'll be a message for all the people. That's not this kind of message. This kind of message is for everyone here, because all of us knows what it is to worry, to feel anxiety. And if we're not currently struggling with it, chances are you know someone very, very close to you who is. We all worry, we all have anxiety, and so today in our resilience series, we're talking about how to come back stronger than ever from these things. If you're taking notes, and I encourage you to, the title of the message is simply this: Overcoming Worry and Anxiety. Now, I want to say at the outset here, I'm aware that this is a bigger issue for some than it is for others. When we talk about worry and anxiety, this is certainly not a one-size-fits-all category. For some of you, your worry and anxiety, it's like a nagging cough, right? It's just always there, doesn't seem to go away. For there others of you, it comes in waves. And that wave crests, and it'll crash down on your soul, and then it goes away. And you know another one's coming, you just don't know when. For the others of you, you're like Jessica. It's debilitating in your life. The anxiety is so overwhelming, so severe, that like her, you feel like you're drowning and you can't catch your breath. She used the term hopeless. And maybe that describes where you are with your anxiety and worry. And so the question today is, does the Bible that we read, the authoritative Word of God that we stand on and stand under, have any word of counsel, advice? Can it speak to our worry and anxiety? And the answer is absolutely yes. And if you have your Bibles, I want to encourage you to take them and turn to Philippians chapter 4. Now, I said in the introductory message of this series, I think it's important to reiterate here, that for some, the best thing you could do for your anxiety, especially if it is overwhelming you to a point of concern, meaning that you do not feel yourself, you're despondent, you're despairing, maybe you feel depressed, I want to encourage you to schedule an appointment with your physician and talk to them about it. There could be some biological contributing factors at play, and it could be that God could use a certain prescription of medicine for this certain time that could help you in a specific and significant way. And if that's the help that you need, I want to encourage you to get that help. That doesn't make you less than. What I believe many of us need as it relates to anxiety and worry is to simply be able to talk about it with someone, to process it. And so it may be that you need to schedule an appointment with a licensed counselor, a biblical counselor. Very minimum, contact our offices. We have on our homepage, championforest.org, a resource page, and it has all of our counselors on staff, seasoned pastors that you can talk to, and we can at least maybe point you in the right direction, listen to you, and allow you to open up. I'm going to be preaching in a few weeks on shame and guilt. And I'm going to talk in that message about the importance of sharing what is dark in your life with someone else, getting that which is dark into the light, because when it's in the dark, it can't grow. And for some, your worry and anxiety, you're keeping it in, you're not talking about it with anyone, and I can promise you, as you keep it in the dark, you will not grow. In fact, the only thing that will grow is you try to hide it, not talk about it. The only thing that will grow is your anxiety, your worry. And so out of the gate, I just want to put a bright light on making sure that you share what's going on in your world with someone. I'm telling you, the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, this is the place to share it. This is why life groups are so important. You know, we break this big church down into small groups for every age, stage, and demographic. And after this service, if you're not in a life group, I really want to encourage you, go to our connections desk and just get a few options and visit them all. When you find the right one, you'll know it's there. But it's in these life groups where you celebrate life's victories with other believers and you walk through life's defeats and you're prayed for and you use your spiritual gifts. And this is where you can share with someone what's going on in your life. They're not going to judge you. They're going to come alongside you. They're going to walk with you, pray with you. I can't encourage you enough to get into a life group. It could be life-changing for you. We've got to talk about it. Word anxious here, it literally means to be pulled in different directions. We get the word worry from an old English word that means to choke or to strangle. And isn't this the perfect picture of what anxiety and what worry does in our lives? We feel like we're coming apart. We feel like we're being choked, strangled. Just like Jessica said, we can't seem to catch our breath, come up for air. This is what anxiety, this is what worry does. And so how can we overcome it? Philippians chapter 4, starting in verse 6. I'm telling you, there's a weight to this message today. I told my wife this week in preparation, I said, baby, this message on worry and anxiety is giving me worry and anxiety, all right? Because I know how significant it is to so very many. And I'm just praying that God will take His word by the power of His Holy Spirit, do what only He can do in these few minutes in His word, and that is to speak and comfort our hearts. Philippians chapter 4, starting in verse 6, the Bible says this: do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, amazing word, isn't it? You ought to circle it there in your Bibles. The peace of God, the exact opposite of what so many people here today and watching online are feeling in this moment. You do anything for peace of mind, for peace of heart, for peace in the deep recesses of your being. The Bible says you bring to God your request, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. If you want to overcome anxiety and worry, it starts by walking down a path called prayer. That's how we overcome it. Prayer. Now, don't check out on me on this. I know what some of you are thinking. Jarrett, that's the best you got? My worries, my concerns, the things that are causing me anxiety. And you're telling me that the answer is as simple as prayer? Because if so, you're going to have to do better than that. I mean, isn't that the thought, Jarrett? Don't bring that. Don't just start speaking Christianese to me. I need something more. Besides that, I have prayed and my anxiety is still present. And so just you saying that, Jarrett, is insulting. More than that, I'm not very strong in my prayer life. And so the fact that you're saying this is the answer, you're just adding to my anxiety. If you're thinking that way, I totally understand, because I felt the same way when reading this passage. And I was praying and I said, God, is this the best you can give me? Because I'm going to have to tell the people that on Sunday. And I'm going to need you to have my back when I do. And as I studied this passage, began to look at what Paul commands here, it became very apparent to me that Paul knew exactly what he was talking about and that prayer really is the answer. You want to overcome your worry. You want to overcome your anxiety. It starts by walking on a path called prayer. Let's work this out. You know, when we study the scriptures, we have a tendency to come to the scriptures and say, okay, God, what do you have to say to me today? What does this say about me? And it's not a bad question to ask. We need to ask that question. But the first question we ask when we come to the scriptures, God, what does this text teach me about you? Because when we learn what it teaches about God, we'll conform to His word, what He says about Himself. And here we get three major insights into what this text teaches about God as it relates to our worry and our anxiety. Number one is this. God knows we are prone to worry and anxiety. This is why Paul makes the command here in Scripture, do not be anxious. It's no secret that we would struggle with this. I mean, remember, God created us, knit us together in our mother's womb, knows the numbers of hair on our head. A sparrow, the Bible says, doesn't fall to the ground without his knowledge. But we know that God is aware of the fact that we struggle with this. In fact, Paul right here in Philippians chapter 4 is simply quoting Jesus. If you're taking notes, write down Matthew chapter 6, verse 25 through 34. You can read it in your own time. It's the Sermon on the Mount. Three times in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus himself, these words are written in red. This is Jesus speaking three times. He's going to tell the people, do not be anxious. And he's speaking to a group of people who were poor. They didn't have anything. And most of them were following him because he fed 5,000 and they didn't know where their next meal was going to come from. They had nothing. And he tells them not to be anxious. I'm talking today to a room full of people who have everything. And he tells us the same thing. Do not be anxious. We have such a tendency to worry. And Jesus knows it's not healthy for us. A couple of weeks ago, I was looking for some side effects to some medicine that I was taking. So I went to WebMD to check it out. Let me encourage you. Never, ever, 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 ever under any circumstances go to WebMD and put something in there, all right? I was starting to feel all sorts of things looking at WebMD, but I knew I was preaching on this passage, and so I just typed in worry. And here's what WebMD says about our worry. Chronic worry can affect your daily life so much that it may interfere with your appetite, lifestyle habits, relationships, sleep, and job performance. Some of you can amen that. Many people who worry excessively are so anxiety-ridden that they seek relief in harmful lifestyle habits such as overeating, cigarette smoking, or using alcohol and drugs. Anxiety disorders are commonplace in the U.S., affecting nearly 40 million adults. And we know with this COVID-19 pandemic, those numbers are only on the rise, all of the stresses and worries of life that that has brought. I'm telling you, Jesus knew what he was talking about when he told the people not to worry in his day, and he knows what he's talking about when he tells us not to worry in our day. It's not good for us. Spiritually, physically, Proverbs chapter 12, verse 25, the first part says, anxiety in a man's heart weighs him down. It's not good. Not only is it not good for us, it doesn't do us any good. Jesus, in that same passage, Matthew chapter 6, verse 27, in which of you by being anxious can add a single hour to his span of life? It's been said that worry is like a rocking chair. It's a lot of work, but you ain't moving nowhere. It's true. Worrying and being anxious doesn't do us any good. But let's be honest. This advice from Paul, do not be anxious, who is again quoting Jesus, do not be anxious. I mean, I read it and on the surface, I want to go, man, you don't know my situation. Like, I want to make an appeal. You have no idea what I'm up against. You don't know the circumstances that I'm facing. And then I start thinking about Paul's life and where he was when he penned Philippians chapter 4. And you want to know where he was? Prison. His circumstances weren't all that rosy either. And according to his own testimony, he had been beaten, he had been shipwrecked, he had been left for dead on occasion. In other words, Paul had some skins on the wall. He knew what he was talking about. And so when we hear him say this command today, do not be anxious about anything, the point is we can take this with authority because Paul knew what he was talking about. We can receive this word. Now listen, what Paul and Jesus are saying here in do not be anxious, they're not saying live in this carefree, careless, laissez-faire, whatever happens, happens kind of mindset. Zippity-doo-dah, all right? That's not what they're suggesting at all. As Christians, we have concerns that come into our lives. The job can get overwhelming at times. Finances can get tight and cause stress. Loved ones get sick and pass away. It can cause worry and anxiety. Relationships can be a struggle. Like everyone else out there, Christians have concerns in life, and we're called to tackle those concerns, meet those concerns head on. What Jesus and Paul are arguing for here is that we've got to make sure that while we have concerns, our concerns don't have us. And so they make this command, don't be anxious. Interesting that most of that which worries us, causes anxiety, is it not true to say most of it that is outside of our control? Like if you were to pinpoint it today, there's nothing you could do about it. And yet, I believe God sent me here today to tell you that what is outside of your control is not outside of His control. And this God can handle our worries and anxieties. In fact, the Bible says He cares for us so very much. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 7, the scripture says, cast all your anxieties on Him because He cares for you. And this casting means to throw. Throw your anxieties, throw your worries on Him. How do we do this? Through prayer. And this is point number two. This text highlights the fact that God knows we are prone to worry, to be anxious. That's why He gives us the command not to be anxious. But secondly, God has given us a means to deal with our worry and anxiety. That's prayer. Cast your anxieties on Him. He cares for you. Look at the second part of verse 6 there in Philippians chapter 4. But in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. I appreciate the fact that Paul doesn't just tell us what not to do. Don't worry, don't fret, don't be anxious, but he tells us what to do. You should pray. Bring your requests to the Lord in prayer. Now, at its most basic level, prayer is engaging God, being in a relationship with Him. And Paul suggests here that we are to pray about everything. That means nothing is too big, nothing is too small for God. If it's big enough to worry about, it's big enough to pray about. And God invites us to do just that. You know, we as parents, you as grandparents, some of you, you love the sound of the voice of your children and grandchildren. Well, don't you know God, our Father, loves the sound of His children? And this is what prayer does for us. Prayer is engaging with God. He uses a word here, supplication. Some of your Bibles, the word petition, it's not a word that we use often. I don't ever get up from dinner and say, okay, Debbie, I'm going to go supplicate for a little bit. We don't talk like that. The dictionary defines supplication as the act of asking or begging for something earnestly or humbly. It's petitioning. And so prayer is engaging God. The best definition I've ever been given of prayer is prayer is relationship. I mean, just as we breathe in air, exhale, that is prayer. It is the lifeblood of the believer. It's who we are more than what we do. Prayer is engaging God. Seeking His face. But it's not just seeking His face, it's seeking His hand. We can ask God for certain things. I'm just telling you, church, the Lord is on me in this area of prayer, unlike a weight I've felt in a long time. And I'm just telling you, come the fall, we're going to have a prayer service here one night during the week, every week, and we're going to get after God in prayer. I don't know when I'm praying through it and thinking through it, but prayer is going to be the backbone of everything that we do. And Jesus invites us to do it. Matthew 7, verses 7 and 8. Ask, and it'll be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and it will be open to you. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds. And to the one who knocks, it will be open. God invites us to call on Him in prayer. Amazing to think about. That the God of the universe, I mean, the one that spoke the world into existence, one who channels the king's heart in His hands, as the old song goes, He's got the whole world in his hands. This God invites us to enter into a relationship with him through prayer where we can bring him our concerns and our worries and our anxieties, and he listens to us. He doesn't only listen to us, but he can do something about our worries and our anxieties and our concerns. He has that kind of power. We can ask him to move on our behalf. We can ask him to give us strength to endure. But it comes by prayer. I couldn't help but think of that old hymn that we sing in church, used to sing that, what a friend we have in Jesus. Thinking about just the fact that God invites us to pray. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Have we trials and temptations? Is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful who will all our sorrows share? Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer. That's what Paul's saying here. Take your worries, take your concerns, bring them before the Lord and earnestly call out to him. Scripture says here, verse 6, that with thanksgiving, we are to let our requests be made known to God. You know why thanksgiving is so important? Because it's a perspective changer. Oftentimes, all we can see when we're in the middle of a crisis is the worry, the anxiety that is right in front of us. It settles in on our life like a fog. What is the scriptural analysis for that fog lifting? It is prayer of thanksgiving. Counting your blessings, because when you do, you see that God is able, that God has moved in the past on your behalf, and that he can move again. You count what God's doing in your life. And those prayers of thanksgiving all of a sudden will just lift that fog and allow you to see clearly once again. This is warfare prayer that I'm talking about. This is not casually engaging the Lord. Now, we see prayers in Scripture. God hears all of our prayers. We see prayers in Scripture. Peter's walking on water, and he begins to drown. He says, Lord, save me. I mean, that's a prayer right there. Lord, save me. The Bible says Jesus immediately reached down and grabbed him. The prayer I'm talking about is not a casual prayer. Not a prayer of an emergency, which, again, God hears. The prayer I'm talking about is warfare prayer. The enemy wants nothing but to steal, kill, and destroy your life. And that's not just physically, that is emotionally. He wants to rob you of peace of mind, peace of heart, keep you up at night. He wants your life so full of anxiety so that you're not walking in confidence with God, not trusting in the Lord. That's what he wants. He'll do everything in his power to make it happen. Jesus came to give you life, the scripture says, and life to its fullest. And one of the ways that we experience this is to grow in this area of prayer. If you're not where you need to be, you're not alone as it relates to being strong in prayer. Most believers that I meet with, if you ask them the two areas they wish they could grow in, it's one of two areas, almost without exception. Prayer and sharing their faith. We all want to get stronger in this. So how do we do it? Let me very quickly just give you three exercises to help you grow in prayer, to strengthen that muscle of prayer, all right? I'm going to need you to use your hands, all right? So you can put your pen, Bibles down. I need you to get your hands ready, all right? Because these are exercises, okay? Just like you exercise a physical muscle, what I'm going to take you through right now is exercising spiritual muscles. You've heard of sweating to the oldies, all right? Richard Simmons, sweating to the oldies. It's like a train wreck. You can't take your eyes off of him, man. I just watch him. This is sweating to the holies, all right? Here we go. You do these exercises, you're going to get stronger in prayer. You ready? Hands down. Just put your hands right here. That's mind on Christ, all right? That's mind on Christ. I'm learning here in Houston. You can put them down. Mind on Christ, all right? More you do it, the stronger you get. I'm learning here in Houston that barbecuing is a thing, okay? like a sport, and people are passionate about it. Like, I'm scared to even ask a question because I'll get like emails and texts, and this is how you should do it and what you should do. I mean, it's important here. I do know a little something about barbecuing, and that is the longer you saturate, the longer you soak that meat in whatever it is, marinate, the longer it goes, the juicier it gets, the better it is. Hey, Christian, the longer we put our mind in God's word, all right, the better it gets, all right? And so when life starts to squeeze us, what comes out is the word of God. We're not driven by our feelings. We're not driven by our emotions, as legitimate as they are. But instead, we are driven by the truth of God's word. And if you don't think this is important in this context here in Philippians chapter 4, just look at verse 8. We read verse 6 and 7. The verse that follows, finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there's any excellence, if there's anything worthy of praise, think about these things. We've talked about the role of the mind in a believer's life. And if you missed any of these messages, I'm telling you, go back and listen to them, because the mind is so very important. Where are you putting your mind? Your mind's got to be on Christ. Think on these things, not what brings confusion, not what brings you down, not what's bringing you discouragement. You think on these things, Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. One of my favorite verses to give people who may be going through a tough time, maybe they're facing a surgery or they're recuperating after a surgery. Isaiah chapter 26, verse 3. You keep him in perfect peace, that word that we're after. You keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you because they trust in you. It's your mind. So, mind on Christ. Second exercise, you ready? Mind on Christ. Let's do it together. Sweating to the holies, mind on Christ. All right, here we go. Knees on the floor. Knees on the floor. All right, mind on Christ, knees on the floor. Here's what that means. Obviously, I'm speaking of prayer, but when I say knees on the floor, it's figurative language. Meaning this, when you take the posture of putting your knees on the floor, you're being intentional. You're prioritizing prayer. It's figurative language for just being intentional about your prayer. Again, this is warfare prayer here. Max Lucado said this, no one can pray and worry at the same time. Amen. You let your worries drive you to Jesus, not further away. You let your anxieties drive you to Christ in prayer. Not as an out, don't look for an outlet anywhere else to relieve the stress, the anxiety, the worry that you're feeling, man. We see it do so much damage, whether it's alcohol or drug abuse, pornography. We're looking at a younger generation. And I'm telling you, God's on me about this too, about reaching the next generation. I want to reach you, but I want to reach your kids and your grandkids as well, because the enemy's stealing from them in so many ways. And so we've got our cell phones out. And I'm telling you, the comparison factor, which is a joy stealer, constantly in social media, and that's not bringing peace. That's adding chaos. And we've got to figure out a way. I mean, that's life. That's what we're living in. But we've got to teach our young people and even adults that, listen, that stuff's going to add anxiety to your life, not take it away. And prayer is where we deal with it. Wasn't even planning on saying that, all right? Listen, Philippians chapter 4, verse 6 and 7. Listen to the Message translation. Don't fret or worry. Instead of worrying, pray. Let petitions and praises shape your worries into prayers, letting God know your concerns. Before you know it, a sense of God's wholeness. Everything coming together for good will come and settle you down. It's wonderful what happens when Christ displaces worry at the center of your life. And so, to develop those prayer muscles, we go mind on Christ. We go knees on the floor. And we go hands in the air. Hands in the air. You know what that is? That's called surrender. You know, sometimes what causes us worry and anxiety, isn't it true? Sometimes it's because of decisions that we made, and there's consequences to those decisions. The Bible says we reap what we sow. And this is why it's important to be a believer in Christ, because when you trust in Christ, God gives you His Holy Spirit to live inside of you. And so you can overcome worry and anxiety as Christ lives in you. The Spirit gives you the power to do that. Sometimes, as a child of God, He allows trials and struggles and temptations in life not to cause us to stumble, but to enable us to stand. And it's to strengthen our faith. And sometimes the very thing that is causing us anxiety and stress has filtered through God's holy hand, and He's allowed it into our life, and we're begging Him to change the situation, to change the circumstance, and what God wants to change is you. And use the circumstance and the situation to do it. And so we're getting anxiety and worry over the current situation, and God says, I sent the situation so that you would call on me, lean on me, come spend time with me. And some of the best thing that some of us could do who are struggling with anxiety and worry today is to go home this afternoon, you get alone with Jesus, and put your hands in the air and just say, God, I surrender. You know me better than I know myself. You know what's good for me. I'm not going to bow my neck against this. I'm not going to try to change this. I received this from you. I'm going to endure it for your glory. Now, by your grace, help me walk through it. And we surrender. It's mind on Christ. Knees on the floor. Hands in the air. You do this, and I promise you, your faith will go stronger, and you will see firsthand why Paul said, don't be anxious about anything, but in everything, pray. Pray. Third thing we notice about God, and we're landing the plane. God's peace is a result of our prayer. We want that peace that passes all understanding. We get it by prayer. Verse 7, and the peace of God which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ. You keep reading into verse 9, and it gets better. You don't only get the peace of God, but look at what verse 9 says. Practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. You don't just get the peace of God, you get the God of peace. That's what prayer does. You need peace, you bring your worries to Christ. I'm telling you, it'll make all the difference in the world. It did for Jessica. Remember her story? Listen to the way, watch the way it ends.
You know, my mind would play all these scenarios that weren't happening, but to me it felt very real, you know. I had to go back to my apartment and see, make sure that it wasn't burnt down, because in my mind, I was like, you need to go check. You left the irons on, you left the stove on, you know. When you get home, your apartment's gonna be burnt down and there's gonna be nothing left. And then I remember coming to work one day and just feeling like I had to run. And I saw my supervisor at the time, and, you know, I remember just seeing her, and I could barely talk, but I just remember breaking down and telling her, I can't do this anymore. And she was like, what are you talking about, you know? And so I kind of tried to explain the best that I could what I was feeling. And I was at the point where I didn't see value in my life. And I felt like my only out was just to not be here anymore. So she brought me to the care and counseling team that we have here at Champion Forest. And I was so in denial about needing help. I was like, no way, like, I don't need help. What are you talking about? Like, I can do this on my own. And he goes, no, I think you really do need help. And I did need help. I needed medical help, but the biggest help that I needed was kind of just to let God break down all these walls that I had built up throughout the years. Once I started, you know, getting the calls from our counsel team, just praying, you know, I started to realize, like, you know, there was hope. I mean, I have friends and just people that'll ask me, how did you overcome this anxiety? And honestly, it took a lot of being on my knees and just praying, crying, you know, feeling the hurt and just allowing Him to come in and put the pieces back together.
Beautiful, isn't it? God will put the pieces back together, but you got to come to Him. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 11, verse 28, one of my favorite passages in all of the scripture, come to me, all you who are tired and have heavy burdens, and I'll give you rest. He didn't say come to a church, come to a program. He said come to me. Come to me, personal relationship. You can't know the peace of God until you've made peace with God. And the way that you make peace with God is by knowing His Son, Jesus Christ. asking Him to come into your life and take control. And so I want every head bowed and every eye closed across this place. If you're joining us online and able, I want you to pray right where you are. If you're here today and you need a personal relationship with Christ, man, you know it. You're here, brought by a friend, new to the area. I don't know what brought you to Champion Forest, what caused you to click online today, but you know you don't know Jesus in a personal way. Would you call on His name right now? The Bible says, call on the name of the Lord and you will be saved. To call on Him is to pray to Him. And it's not the words that you say. He sees your heart. It's the faith that you exhibit. And you call on His name and just pray, God, forgive me of my sin. We're all sinners. The Bible says all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Ask Him to forgive you and to come into your life and be your Lord and Savior. Just a simple prayer of faith. Jesus, save me. That happens by believing that He is the Son of God, believing that He went to a cross and He died for your sins, that He was buried and He was raised to life, believing this message, not just with your head, but with your heart. That's what changes you. And I'm believing that many people here today are praying right now, save me. And if you are, you need to know that God instantaneously saves you, gives you His Holy Spirit, changes you forever. In just a moment, we're going to stand and sing what we call a hymn of invitation. And we invite you to make that decision public. If you're a little boy, a little girl, and you prayed asking Jesus into your heart, you ask mom and dad. And if they're okay with it, they'll walk with you down here to tell a pastor, I just asked Jesus into my heart. If you're an older adult, you came with a friend, they'll come with you. I've never met anybody who regretted making their decision public to follow Jesus. You come forward, you tell a pastor, we want to celebrate with you, we want to pray with you, we want to put some resources in your hand to help you grow. If you're in the balcony area, you don't have to come all the way down. Our pastors are going to be right there at the exits. You can go to them if you're making a decision today. Others of you, you're Christians, but you don't have a church home. You don't have anyone to lock arms with and walk through life with. You need to come forward today and join Champion Forest. Today would be a great day to join. You just tell the pastor, I want to join the church, and we'll sign you up for our membership class, and that's where you become a member. But you come forward today. We'll rejoice with you. And then there's others. Man, you're struggling. And you just want somebody to pray with you. There's power in prayer. There's power when we pray together. Our pastors are going to be here. If you need prayer, you come forward and we'll pray over you. Ask God to free you, relieve you, help you as only He can. Father, in Jesus' name, this is your time of invitation where you've spoken to hearts. Lord, we have but one response. And that is to move by faith in a way that honors you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. And all God's people said, amen and amen. As you look up, I'm going to ask you to stand up. Our pastors are here and here and here and here. You see them in the balcony area right there at the exits. If you're making a decision today, right now, as we begin singing, I want you to come. Don't wait. Right now, you come. Come on, right now.
Oh, my fear.
Come on. You came with someone, they'll come with you. You need prayer? Come on. Joining the church, trusting in Christ, God bless you. Let's celebrate this coming. Come on. Who else? Who else? Who else? Come on. Beautiful. Who else? God bless you, sir. Let's pray. Look, come on, let's celebrate. We're watching God move. We want to pray with you. We want to welcome you to our faith family. Come on. God bless you. Oh, come on. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful.
Oh, there's power that can break off.
Who else?
There's power that can empty out a grave.
Anybody else?
There's resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name. Power in your name.
Last time through, last time.
My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. chance when I stand in your love.
Oh, that's so good. Let's celebrate with all those that came forward today. We say welcome to the family of God. Welcome to Champion Forest. And we've got some that we're baptizing today, Champion Forest. Every week here, we're seeing lives changed by the power of the gospel. And so let's turn our attention to the baptistry as we see these lives changed. And let's celebrate like nobody's business what God has done in their life. Paul?
Good morning, Champion Forest. This is Ella. So Ella, are you following Jesus today in baptism because you're accepting him as Lord and Savior? All right. But because of that profession of faith, I now baptize you as my sister in Christ in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Come on, Knox. And we have Knox. So Knox, yep, you got it. So are you following Jesus in baptism because you're accepting him as Lord and Savior?
Yes, sir.
All right. Because of that profession of faith, I now baptize you as my brother in Christ in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We have Crystal. This is Crystal. Are you following Jesus in baptism because you have accepted him as Lord and Savior?
Yes.
All right. Because of that profession of faith, I now baptize you as my sister in Christ in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Yeah. And now we have Anthony. So are you following Jesus in the baptism?
Yes.
Because you have made him Lord and Savior, accepting him as Lord and Savior.
Yes.
All right, you was ready for this. That's what I'm talking about. So I now baptize you as my brother in Christ in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And this is Teresa. Hey. So are you following Jesus in baptism because you have made him, you have accepted him as Lord and Savior?
Yes.
All right. Well, because of that profession of faith, I now baptize you as my sister in Christ in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. There we go. Buried with Christ in baptism and raised to walk in a newness of life.
So awesome. Never gets old. Never gets old. And Champion Forest, never get over seeing lives changed by the power of the gospel. It's so beautiful. This is why we do what we do. It's why we give. It's why we go in his name. And so grateful for what God is doing here through this incredible church. One major announcement before you go, and we'll call it a day, and that is this. I need you to mark on your calendars August 7th and 8th. That weekend is going to be what we're calling homecoming weekend, all right? We were not able this past year due to COVID to celebrate the 50th anniversary of our church like we wanted to. And so we're going to on August the 7th and 8th. You're going to hear more about it. We're going to have an opportunity in the service on the 8th to honor Pastor Damon Shook. His wife Jackie's going to be here along with the whole family. It's going to be a great day where we look to the past. Yeah, absolutely. You can celebrate that. Where we look to the past, but we also look to the future and celebrate all God has done and what he's going to do. And so if you're on vacation, I want you to put that date down so you come back from vacation, all right? August the 7th and 8th. God bless you, Champion Forest. Have a great day as you go. We'll see you next week.